I would like to take this opportunity to outline the breadth and strength of the study of gender and sexuality at our Amsterdam Institute for Social Science Research. We are, of course, as we all know, a large institute where four core social science disciplines come together. And as there are distinct epistemological differences, there are also binding elements. One is, of course, the passion and to engage with questions that concern us all as citizens and as scholars in a world that is fast changing. Another is that certain themes are central to many scholars across the board, and this is certainly the case for the theme of gender and sexuality. Matters of gender and sexuality crisscross the AISSR, and the Amsterdam Research Center for Gender and Sexuality provides the forum for synergistic research and teaching at the University of Amsterdam. The study of gender and sexuality taps into the state-of-art research that many current staff members are already engaged in, and I won't mention names because there are too many. And as you will see later in the films, this means they contribute to my debates on migration, health, gentrification, and philosophy of science. These are the four films later. It builds on a productive and innovative feminist studies tradition of interdisciplinarity, and it situates the UVA in an international academic context, enabling new international scholarly collaborations, providing intellectual visibility to current research, and we are attracting new students at all levels. Particularly, we are also engaging in timely interventions in public debates in the Netherlands, in Europe, and in fact, the world. The intellectual transformations of women's studies into gender studies and gay and lesbian studies into sexuality studies have produced a new interest in the way social norms, cultural forms, and political regulations shape lives, sexual practices, and gendered identities. This new interest converges with larger societal problems around globalization and localization, nationalism and the nation state, inequality, migration, religious revival, and many more pertinent questions. I would almost refer to the films we have just seen. These problems are frequently connected to issues of gender and sexuality, such as civil rights, human trafficking, labor movements, health, sexism, homophobia, but also the way elections are played out, as we have recently witnessed in the US. Explanations of these phenomena can often benefit from the theoretical and methodological insights developed within gender and sexuality studies. Whereas public debate is often mired by problematic and unrecognized assumptions, scholars in this field provide a much needed context for understanding of many of these complex problems. So gender and sexuality scholarship has opened up novel ways to investigate identity-producing mechanisms in everyday life that not only focus on the, let's say, usual questions of social problems of citizenship or public health, but also on the more upbeat aspects of intimate life, such as pleasure, intimacy, and love. In addition, it has tied gender to the emancipation and visibility of women and sexual minorities, while simultaneously problematizing categories such as masculinity, heterosexuality, or motherhood. It has reclaimed the body as an object of research, locating it at the convergence of the subjective and the structural, and has foregrounded the relationship between gender and sexuality and many other categories such as race or class and so on. So the unique selling point of gender and sexuality at the AISSR is that while it taps into the state-of-the-art theorizing that is mostly initiated in the humanities, the distinctive quality of our research here is that it is firmly grounded in empirical research. I would like to emphasize that the study of gender and sexuality at the AISSR encapsulates the wide scope of existing methodologies and that multidisciplinarity is at the heart of what we do. So let me outline briefly the study of sexuality because that's maybe the most unknown one. The long tradition in the humanities, such as history, philosophy, and cultural studies, to rethink sexuality beyond a deterministic biomedical approach, which is partly responsible, for instance, for thinking about the female gender as locked in biology, and as such giving rise to normative ideas about femininity as limited to motherhood, but also about the way homosexuality was once understood as a psychological disorder, and how thanks to social movements in society that spearheaded research in the academy, we have altered our understanding of the pathological category and how it has been removed from medical books in the 1980s. So in other words, knowledge about gender and sexuality is always in motion, and thinking critically about its production and the emerging normative truth claims are at the heart of what we do. And this is very much in dialogue with the humanities, whereas we focus the research in the empirical studies. As you will later see, the scholarship takes various forms, and I will briefly map a few larger patterns. One, there's a long history of studying social movements. This kind of research is always in tune with society and closely follows social movements and groups in various societies, such as the feminist movement, the gay movement, but also migrant movements or youth movements. This scholarship theorizes notions of citizenship, processes of inclusion and exclusion, democracy and rights. Related to this kind of research are studies focusing more on discourses of gender and sexuality, on truth claims, the debates in the public sphere, and what they tell us about the state of the country or of, for example, Europe. The way gender and gay rights have become mainstream in Dutch politics is an interesting twist in Dutch history, and studies focusing on what is termed now homo-nationalism attempt to interpret this emergence and its implications. Another strand of research focuses more on behavior and practices of groups and or individuals. One group of researchers tries to capture patterns in populations or between groups, and this more quantitatively oriented scholarship provides the knowledge to understand larger patterns within a society or across societies. More qualitatively oriented research complements this work with in-depth analysis concerning people's motivations and experiences. So the spectrum of research that we have here is vast and encompasses a large variety of possible research topics, ranging from age, health, urban living, ethnicity, class, religion, music, mobility, development, art, war, and so on. And that's why I say I cannot mention all the people engaged, because somewhere in many research projects, gender and or sexuality are incorporated. So the behavior and practices of groups and or individuals is at the heart of ethnographic research, and this field is well developed at the ASSR. This field also moves beyond Europe. At the ASSR, we have a strong tradition of research that takes the world as its playing field. My own work focuses on Africa, particularly on Ghana and Kenya. And in my new project, I'm sorry, Brian, that was another project that you mentioned. That was an NWO open competition, but my VD project is slightly different and only focuses on Africa. It's entitled Sexuality and the Making of the Middle Class, a comparative study of desire and status in three African countries. I will investigate here the interface between sexuality and the middle class. So in a way, you can say that I use sexuality as a lens to look at larger social patterns. I will use a historical ethnographic approach to study the pursuit of social mobility and how this has impacted on gender relations and on sexuality. I will use family histories as a vantage point from which to analyze changing notions of gender and sexuality and of class distinction. Four contentious questions stand central, contentious questions in public debates. These are homosexuality, bright wealth, female circumcision, and polygamy. These are issues that are often conceptualized as traditional and therefore assumed to be stable. However, groups that aspire middle-class status play a salient role in the debates about these issues, as they often look differently upon these customs and aspire change in them. They are also fiercely criticized for that, as gender and sexuality become effective tools in moral debates about culture, just like the way women and gay rights have become central in debates in the Netherlands about the changing nature of society here. I will study, with a team that still has to be assembled, people's personal choices by focusing on questions of love, intimacy, and self-realization, and how people position themselves in relation to these politicized debates. An important motivation to focus on the middle classes and on love and affection is to engage with the partial production of knowledge about Africa as poor and mainly miserable, and where sexuality is often studied as a problem of age, of sexual violence, and many more. In other words, I'm interested in the way historical trajectories have shaped the present, the production of knowledge about gender and sexuality, and ultimately how the lived experiences of people inform our theoretical models. For example, I do not use notions of like heterosexuality or homosexuality, because these terms cannot capture the essence of how body, gender, and desire relate, as they are grounded in a Western logic based on opposite binaries, and therefore they are very much rooted in a particular Western cultural history. I am eventually therefore interested to study African realities as heuristic tools to rethink our conceptual repertoire, not only to go there to find data. So looking at the breadth of gender and sexuality at the ASSR, we can conclude that it is used as a crucial variable to understand processes of migration or voting, to taking up gender and sexuality as an analytical concept to identify underlying factors in social, political, and economic processes, such as the question why there are less female CEOs, or the question why burkinis gives rise to such heated emotional public debates. Moreover, it's a unique vantage point to delve deeper into the philosophy of science, into the way we are all engaged in knowledge production. The work presented by Willem Botermans, Anita Hardon, Erik Fischer, and Stephanie Steinmetz show how the study of gender and sexuality is firmly grounded in disciplines, while it has also the potential for the interdisciplinary dialogue in the ASSR, but certainly at the UvA. In that sense, gender and sexuality has a great potential for innovative ways to look at personal questions and large social problems we are encountering now, just as Brian had outlined at the beginning. Because gender and sexuality are crucial analytical tools to understand the world and current pertinent questions of religion, migration, or democracy. Thank you.